Today is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday is a very joyful day. Yet at the same time, Palm Sunday is it's a kind of a confusing day as well. When we have a service here, there are expectations. When I go home with Mita, I know what ought to have happened. And sometimes we talk about, well, how did it go? What did you think? Well, I thought that was really good. What did you think was good? Well, I thought people sang as if they meant it. I think people prayed. I think that, the people listened to the teaching of the Word of God. I saw expressions of love and people reaching out to one another. I think God was really working amongst us. I thought that really went well. But if at the end of the day, when Jesus returned after the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and the disciples and he were talking, and he were to say to them, well, how did you think it went? How do you think it went? I'm not sure that everybody would understand what he's talking about, because nobody would really know, what was the expectation? What really were we doing there? There would be some confusion. In fact, the Word of God tells us that the disciples were confused about it. They didn't understand, didn't realize what was going on until later, when they realized that Jesus was fulfilling prophecy. Some people say that, well, Jesus was offering himself as a king, and he was kind of hoping that maybe this would be their last chance and they would respond and they would take him as their king. But that doesn't make sense, because Jesus had told his disciples on three different occasions that he was going to Jerusalem and he was going to suffer at the hands of the priests and the Pharisees, and they were going to torture him and kill him. And then on the third day he was going to rise. How do we fit those two together? Certainly they couldn't receive him as king and make him the king of Israel if indeed his plan was that he was going to die. So what really was going on there? It wasn't that he was trying to offer himself to them as a king and that they would place him on the throne and the Romans would have to leave. That really wasn't the plan. What was the plan? Well, I guess the best way to find out what the plan was is to look at what scriptures say. Like, for instance, the passage that's given to us concerning him riding the donkey. There was a passage taken from the Old Testament that prophesied his actually doing that. And that helps us understand what was going on. It comes from Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. I'll read it for you. It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem." So that tells us, first of all, that what's going on here was to be a thing of joy. So to look back on that and say, how did it go? Well, I think that was pretty successful. There was a lot of joy. There was a lot of worship going on as Jesus was making his way into Jerusalem. "See, your king comes to you." So in a real sense, the prophecy is saying that this was a presentation of Jesus as king. Okay. "Your king comes to you righteous and having salvation, gentle, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Well, there's a kind of an interesting twist here, because when a king comes to offer himself as king, normally he would come riding on something regal, something like a horse or a camel. But he came riding on a donkey. There's something different about him. I think that even as he was coming down the mountain, people were wondering, we're proclaiming him king. Why is he on a donkey? What is that about? Some people probably remembered the passage from the Old Testament and said, this is what God said would happen. And that would be helpful for them. But others probably would just wonder. We were kind of hoping that he would become king and that he would cast the demon Romans out. But he didn't appear to be doing that. Riding on a donkey, the colt and the foal of a donkey. Notice that he is righteous and having salvation and gentle. What kind of kingdom are we talking about here? If Jesus is offering himself as a king, and yet he knows that he will not be crowned as king, is this really a colossal failure? That he goes down the mountain into Jerusalem to the temple, and everybody sort of just like, well, okay, what do we do next? I don't know. Let's go home. Was that a failure? Would the disciples say, that didn't seem like that went well. We kind of had other expectations. Now, you remember that when Jesus fed the 5,000, that there was this groundswell of, let's make him king. And Jesus tells the disciples to get into the boat. And they are taken away because he doesn't want them to get caught up in this groundswell. He was not here to become a political king. Well, what kind of king was he kind to be? Jesus explains that to us, explains it to Pilate in the 19th chapter of John, 18th chapter of John, when he is on trial. Jesus has come to be a king, and he is offering himself as a king, but he is not the kind of king they are looking for. He says in John 18:36, Jesus said, my kingdom was not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place. Well, then you are a king then, says Pilate. Jesus answered, you're right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world. That's an interesting statement because babies don't come into the world. Babies are born in the world. He is one who came into the world. He was born for a different purpose. He said to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. And so he speaks to them about the nature of the kingdom that he came to be king of. It is not a kingdom of this world. That doesn't mean that the people of his kingdom are not in the world. They are. But they are totally different from a worldly kingdom. A worldly kingdom establishes itself by its own armies, by its power, political power, by its ability to force its will upon someone else. A king, then, is a political king, and it's a worldly kind of system. But Jesus is different. He said to Pilate, if I was an earthly king, my followers would have defended me against the Jews. They are not that kind of kingdom. It is a kingdom of heaven. It is a kingdom in the hearts of men. Men and women who are living in the earth, no question. It is an earthly kingdom in that sense of people who live on the earth. But it is a kingdom that is in the power of God rather than the power of armies. It is the power of God that revolutionizes a person. He says, because I am come to testify concerning the truth. And those who desire the truth, everyone on the side of truth, listens to me. Those who are in my kingdom are those who listen to what I say concerning the truth. Now, let's talk a little bit about truth. Is it about facts? Is he saying that these people know something that other people don't know? Well, yes, but it's much more than that. Jesus said, I am the way, the life and the truth. I'm sorry, the way, the truth, and the life. Okay, there we go. Let's get that straight. And he talks about the fact that he is truth. He is truth. back in chapter 9 of John, he has a time with the Pharisees, and he is debating with them in a sense. And they are criticizing him and telling him that he has a demon, that he's a Samaritan. It is a dastardly kind of conversation. But Jesus responds to them and says to them, "You are like your father, the devil. You are like your father, the devil. He was a murderer from the beginning and a liar. And he is the father of lies." So what Jesus is saying, that there are in this world kingdoms that are under what we call the lie that was told back in the Garden of Eden, that you do not need God, that God does not have your interests, your best interests at heart. You need to go your own way. You need to determine your own path. You need to depend upon yourself. That is the lie. Jesus came to bear witness to the truth. He is the truth in that he lived that truth all of his life. He lived in complete dependence upon the Father, something that Adam should have done instead of taking his allegiance to himself. And so Jesus, from birth until the death of the cross, lived in complete dependence upon God. And that is the truth. That is what God intended for men to live like, in dependence upon him. Men did not. Men chose to sin. The world became the place that we see it now as, because they believed the lie. Jesus came to bear witness to the truth. The truth is that men can live as a result of a relationship with God. But in order to get into that relationship, their living in the lie has to be rectified. It needs to be paid for. The sins that they are guilty of need somehow to be made right again. And so he comes to be the truth. That is the love of God. And he exemplifies that by going to the cross in obedience to him. And that obedience to him, which is a model to us, became the way in which we could come to God for salvation. And those whom the Spirit helps to understand that that is the truth will come to him. They enter into his kingdom, and that is the kingdom that he is calling forth, even as he is going down the Mount of Olives into Jerusalem. His presentation of himself has a way of weeding out or revealing the hearts of men. Are they those who believe the truth, that desire the truth, or are they those who still desire the lie and will want to live for that lie? If we look at the reactions of different people, we learn some important things. First of all, there is the reaction of the crowd. Where are they in all of this? Do they want him to become king? Are they actually part of the kingdom that he's talking about? They call him king. They rejoice that blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed, even the king of Israel. They call him the king. But their desire is totally different from what his is. They have no desire to enter into that kingdom that he is offering, where he is king and rules over their lives, restoring them to that which where they should have stayed with in the Garden of Eden, trusting God and obeying him and finding the blessedness of that life that he offers. So he's going down this mountain, and people are responding with great fervor. How wonderful that is, isn't it? Well, Jesus weeps on the way down the mountain. If you had only known the time of your visitation. Those are not words of commendation. Those are words of sorrow, that even though this is an enthusiastic worship on your part, many of you have no understanding as to what you are asking for. You say, Hosanna, Hosanna, which means, Lord, save. Lord, give us success. But you're looking for a totally different success, a worldly success, a success that is under the umbrella of the lie, where you want to run your lives the way you want them run. You don't want oppression from the Romans. So save us. But the words that are written there from Psalm 118 were not intended for that kind of salvation. Jesus was actually called to come and give salvation from ourselves, not from the Romans. You can change the Romans to the Greeks, change them to any nationality you want to, but the problem remains in the people's hearts. That is where the salvation is needed, and this is what Jesus is offering. Yes, you're asking me, so Hosanna, yes, I will save. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. I come in the name of the Lord, and his calling for me is to be a lamb, a sacrificial lamb. It's interesting that on this day of the feast of the Passover, the celebration over a week, this is the day in which the lambs are chosen. You go back to Exodus chapter 12. This was the process. This is what Moses was told, that on the 10th of Nisan, those who were within Israel were to choose a lamb. And they were to keep it for 3 days. There was this waiting period, and then they were to slaughter it. See the same kind of pattern in the Holy Week, in this week that we're now entering into. The Lamb is chosen. That is his presentation as he comes as King. We choose you. We choose you. And it's interesting that at his feet, most likely, as he is proceeding into the city, there are probably flocks of lambs being guided in for the slaughter. The imagery is like breathtaking to think about the fact that Jesus, the Lamb of God, offering himself to Israel as their king, is actually also offering himself as the Lamb that will take away, that will save. Hosanna, save us. I am. That's what I'm doing. I have a feeling also that there's something wonderful in this worship that's going on. Not that everybody there is understanding. They're not. Because at the end of the chapter, it says that the people still did not believe in him. But Jesus can receive strengthening from this, because this was what God ordained to have happened. He can receive strength from this because it reminds him of what is going to happen. That when he returns to heaven, he will come into heaven to shouts of worship and praise. Will that give him encouragement as he considers going to the cross? Yes. Sort of like the Mount of Transfiguration, as he talks with Moses and Elijah, and they refer to him, they speak to him about his coming death. Encouragement to continue on. Like the angel that came in the garden and strengthened him, and he prayed all the more intensely. There were these encouragements that came along the way. And so here we have the people worshiping, but they don't understand what's going on. Yet Jesus, though he weeps for them because of their lack of understanding, can also be reminded at the same time of what he is waiting for in heaven, or what is waiting for him. What about the reaction of the disciples? The reaction of the disciples is that they worshiped him too. They put their coats on the donkey so that he might be able to not have to make contact with the flesh of this animal. It was a way in that culture of honoring him. They honored him, went down with him, watched all the people worshiping, and I'm sure they got caught up in the whole worship thing as well. They had more understanding, perhaps, but still, at the same time, it says to us that first his disciples did not understand all this. Actually, Jesus had told them that he did not want to become a political king. And here he is offering himself as the king. That was a little confusing. Of course, it says here also that after Jesus was glorified, did they realize that these things had been written about him and they had done these things to him? And so they were processing what was going on. A lot of the time in our lives, we're processing things. Things happen, and then we're like, what was that? Why did that happen? We think about it. And God, the Holy Spirit, helps us to understand and put it in its context. Now, here's a reaction I think is really, really telling. We have the Pharisees who see what's going on. They said to one another, see, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him. What's happening here is not only is Jesus offering himself as a king that is of a kingdom that's not of this earth, a kingdom of God, but he is also igniting what will end up being his crucifixion. It is like a catalyst. For him to ride down into Jerusalem was way over the top as far as these Pharisees were concerned. They had looked for ways to kill him, looked for ways to insult him, to humiliate him in front of the people. And here it is, he's riding a donkey into the city and people are worshiping him. We're just not doing what we need to do here. And so they're moving to the nuclear option. And I understand what that is, right? They're moving to the nuclear option here and saying, all right, we're going to kill him. We are going to kill him. And that was part of what Jesus was doing. He knew that by the end of the feast, he would need to be on a cross. And he was deliberately starting everything into motion, so that by that time, he would be crucified. He revealed the hearts of these Pharisees. There's a great revelation that comes up in the trial when Jesus is before Pilate, and Pilate recognizes that he is not going to get anywhere with these men. And so, in desperation, he brings Jesus out. Jesus has been beaten, and he's bleeding all over. Flesh has been ripped off his body. He says, behold the man. And they say, crucify him, crucify him. And Pilate says, crucify your king? And they said, he is not our king. We have only one king. And the right answer for them to say is that our king is God. I mean, that's what they should have said. But they said this: we have no king but Caesar. Revealing their hearts that really all they were about was the political power that they wanted to keep for themselves. They did not want their people to be taken away. They did not want their nation to be taken away. They were in control, and they were not about to let some young upstart take it away from them. And in the process, they revealed what was their true heart. It was about power. It was not about who is king. Though Jesus calling himself a king was the presenting charge against him. Pilate began to get ideas that he was indeed the king. But he did not act upon it. He said several times, he is innocent. There is no reason for charge. But these Pharisees had been stirred beyond the tipping point, and they had to have their way. Lastly, at the end of this chapter, there is another reaction I think is important, and that is in John 12:20. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the feast. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. They came to him. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. And Philip went to tell Andrew. And Andrew and Philip turned to tell Jesus. These Greeks coming to Jesus were a great encouragement to Jesus. The Pharisees had said, see, the whole world is going after him. And as Jesus is in the temple, and these Greeks come to him, God the Father says to him through these Greeks, yes, indeed, your death will be for the whole world. These people are thinking only about the power they want to keep over Jerusalem. I'm thinking about a kingdom that includes every tribe and nation in the world. And when Jesus sees these men, he says, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Jesus gets it. There are only two Greeks here. But if I fall into the ground and die, they will multiply. There will be believers all over the world. He found encouragement in that. He says, now my heart is troubled, but what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. You see, Jesus is the truth. When someone behaves as God has created him, to be one who is in submission to the will of the Father, this person, like Jesus, can look into the face of suffering and death and say, this is what I was called for. And I will submit to God and do his will. Hallelujah. That we serve a Savior who is truth. He is what God created men to be. And he invites us to come and to find forgiveness and to come and find life as it was intended, to be people of the truth that live the way Jesus lived in complete submission to the Father. We come here tonight, this morning, to celebrate this, and I'm going to invite the men to come forward at this time as we think and we meditate upon the death of Jesus. We take upon the elements and we participate in the eating of them. We are reminding ourselves of what Jesus has done and what he offers to us through his body, who was torn. His flesh, which was the curtain that hid his deity in the sense that the fullness of it could not be seen, but it was revealed in his death in ways in which only those whom the Spirit of God opens their eyes can see it and desire it for themselves. And so, for a moment now, let us, as we come to the table, he tells us that we should take a time to examine our hearts. And if there are attitudes, if there are things that have become idols in our lives, this is our opportunity to submit them to the Lord, to turn them over and say, I forsake these things. I want to be a person of the truth as you have created me to be. So let's pray together silently.